everyone, welcome back to my channel. On my channel I make a lot of dresses and I also make them often out of chiffon or another very thin fabric. And that means that whether you have to line the dress or you need to wear a slip dress underneath it. And because I don't always like to line it, I'm a very fan of slip dresses because you can wear them. You can one slip dress under all your dresses, and it's much more convenient than lining all your dresses. So I already have a white and a black one, but I wanted to show you how you can very easily make one yourself, because they are rather expensive in the shops. So I thought, well, I'll show you how to make them, then you can just make one or two just in the colors that you can use the most, and then you don't have to line all your dresses, because that is more work, and if you don't have to, that's more easy to do. So what you need is your basic pattern for the top. If you haven't, if you don't have your basic pattern yet, I will link down below the tutorial, my tutorial, how you can make your basic pattern. And when you've made it, save it, because you can always use that for all the other tutorials where we make tops or dresses. So it's just the same basic pattern you can use every time again. And what I did was say, if I get a closer view in frame. The basic pattern has the apex but not the cut in for the darts there. I already did that on my basic pattern if you didn't cut that in. And then what you do is when you use that for your new pattern and you want to use the dart, you open the, it up a little bit, your the dart, say 2 centimeters or so. So your pattern will shift a little bit, but you don't really need to use that shifting of the pattern, because you should do it like this. But I normally just give it here more the opening and the movement of this curve a little bit, but you don't really have to do that too much. Then mark on your pattern, or when you have traced your basic pattern on your new pattern, the new curve for the neckline, because a slip dress just has spaghetti straps on the shoulder. So on the middle of the shoulder I mark down where I want my strap to start and the top to stop, and I measured how low I want my neck hole to be on the chest. So mark how low you want this to be. I don't make adjustable straps, because you can make the straps as long as as short as you need, and you, when it's your size, you don't have to change it. Well, I don't change my adjustable straps. I do it once when I buy something and then I don't ever change it again. So I just make straight straps. That's easier to do and it saves you time and money, because you don't have to buy the rings and the clasps and so. So mark where how low you want your neck hole to be. Go in a curve to the middle of the shoulder, and I did it 10 centimeters below the shoulder seam. And then go in a curve back to where your armhole ends. And then lay that on your fabric. Or mark it on your new pattern. And then we're gonna follow this side seam. But I will make it a little bit looser. So I give it 1 centimeter in the armhole. And I don't give it a really that waist that I have. Maybe yours is already a little bit more less curved, but this is too much for slip dress. I want it to be flowy and soft and not too tight on the waist, because that doesn't feel nice. And because your material is very thin, you don't have to make your slip dress really that tight also, not even when you're wearing a tighter dress on top of it. Just make it a little bit less curved than you already had, and mark your length. What you also could do with the pattern is flare it a bit out to the seam. Make it some wider to the seam. That makes it a bit more loose around the legs. But that also can give you a problem when you have a somewhat tighter dress, that your underskirt, your slip dress has too much fabric. So don't make it too wide. If you want to give it some, just give it a bit, that you just have some room to move. And for the fabric that you can use, usually slip dresses are made of satin, And you can certainly do that, but I would recommend to buy then a rather expensive satin or rather and not just a plain polyester, because that will cling to your skin. It feels sweaty and it gets static usually. So then buy a satin made out of silk or a better quality polyester. What you also can do, because what the only thing that is really important is that it's a very sleek fabric, is just take a very sleek jersey, and that is what I have. This is a lingerie jersey, and you can also use that for slip dresses or for underskirts. And the important thing is that the fabric, the upper fabric will flow over your under fabric, so flow over your slip dress, because that is it shouldn't cling to it, because otherwise your top dress won't fall over, but just sticks to it. And that's what you can feel to the fabric. You can feel if it's nice and sleek enough for your undergarment. So you don't really have to use a satin. You can also take any other fabric that is really sleek. And if it's stretchy, that's really a pro, because that gives more comfort to your when you're wearing it. And of course, for your front pattern, mark the apex, mark where the darts should be, that you can sew that dart later on. So don't forget to mark that when you have cut out your piece. We'll have to cut some more, but I want to show you how you sew them together. You put them on a 90 degree angle, right sides together of course, and then you sew them on a 45 degree angle, and then when you open that seam up, you have it nicely aligned and you don't have a bulky straight seam. So you're gonna sew all the strips together that you have one long strip. And then you can just cut off how much as you need. Then what we're gonna do is we're gonna make the straps, and we're gonna do that by making bias tape. And you can do that with such a thing. You cut strips and then you push the fabric into this thing. You pull it out and it folds the fabric, the strap, into a bias tape. And when you iron it, immediately when you take it out and you iron it, then you get a really nice and flat bias tape. But you also can do it where you don't have this thing. I don't know what it's called. It's from Prim and it's a 25 millimeters. But you can also do it yourself, and I show you when I've got my strips. So I'm gonna cut strips of 58 millimeters, because I need 48 millimeters, sorry. I need it for this thing to use, but you can take any width you want. Just see how small you want your straps to be and then cut those pieces. And you need a lot. Also, cut them on the diagonal, because that gives it stretch to your strap. And then when you've done that, I'll show you how this thing works. You put your fabric in the wider part, and you always need something to glide it through. So usually I take just a pin to pull it through. That's already coming. And then when you take it out, you see it folds itself. You must make sure that here it is in the middle, I'm gonna say, and then when you pull it out, you see it folds itself into a bias tape. And when you have your iron on hand, then you can iron it down, and then it keeps its place. So it's a very handy thing to have when you have to make lots of bias tapes. The only thing is, you can only make this width with this one, but when you fold it together, what we're gonna do, you see it's, I think, the perfect width for a strap or whatever thing you need when you want to finish something with bias tape. So I think this is a nice width, 25 millimeters, that's this width. And if you don't want to do it with this, just do it yourself. Then take your iron, first fold it in two and iron this down. Then you have here a nice clean line. Maybe if I do it with my nail, you can see that. And then you open it up, and then you fold your sides to that line that you just ironed. this one and the other one too, and then iron these two. I'll usually do iron just first one and then the other side, and then you see you have the same bias tape. So you can do that too if you don't have this thing to work with. So I'm gonna cut the rest of my strips, gonna sew them together, gonna iron them into a bias tape, and then we're gonna sew the dress. And when you want to sew on bias tape, you have two choices. What you can do is you put your fabric in between in the fold, and then you sew it in one way, the front and the back together with your fabric in between. But what I usually do, just in case, is I fold it open. I fold one inside seam open and I sew this first on the garment, and then you fold it back closed over the fabric, and then I sew this double one. And then you don't have the problem that sometimes your fabric, when you put it in between, is not the backside is not attached, and then you have this loose end. And when you first do the back and then you fold it over with the fabric in between and you stitch it over, then you top stitch it, then you don't have the problem that it will not be attached all the way around. So that is to be secure, to be sure that it is secured okay. But when you are confident, you can just put it in between and do it in one row. So for example, if you want to do this side, then you go on the wrong side, you put the right sides together of your bias tape to the wrong side of your fabric. You open this side up and you sew in this seam, in this line. And when you've sewn that, you open it up and you fold over your bias tape just like that. And then you top stitch it from this side. And then you're sure that your back is secure because you've done that first, and that this is in between, and you secure this one, and then it's always okay when you do it like this. For the camisoles, you're gonna need just a plain simple camisole or tank top. I like mostly the ones with the spaghetti straps, because then they have more open neckline than when you have a normal tank top. So I have a white and a black one, and then find some matching lace, and preferably stretchy lace. My white is really stretchy. For the black, I really couldn't find nice lace. And this one is not stretchy, though I'm not that happy with that, but I just need a little piece, so it's not really such a problem. And then what you do is you put it on top, on the top of the tank top. I have this paper. Normally I put the paper underneath, because then you can see what the pattern is of your lace, and you can see where you or how you want it on your tank top or your camisole. And I like the scalloped hem, of course, on top. And then I watch what is nicest to have as the bottom of the lace, because we're gonna cut off the fabric of the camisole underneath. So I always see when it's nicely aligned from left to right. And then I mark where I want my lace to end. And usually I just mark where I want to sew it on and where I want to cut it off. And usually you can follow the pattern. There you can do the zigzag sewing it on to your camisole and just on the insides from where you made your zigzag, you're gonna cut away the camisole. So mark out the line where you want to stitch it. I pinned on my lace on both the camisoles, and make sure that you end your lace between the straps, because you must cut out only until the straps, not further than, because you need this to hang on to the fabric. So stay in between for both the camisoles. This one too, stay in between the straps. And I marked with my pins where I want my zigzags to be. And for the fabric of the camisoles, you can take any kind. You can take cotton ones, but you can also take polyester ones like this one. It doesn't really matter. You can use whatever you like and whatever you feel is nicest to wear. The slip dress and the camisoles all together, and I really like this old-fashioned fabric for this one. I wanted a nude one because I already just made a white one and I had a black one, so that's why I made this nude one. And it's a different material as that you normally have, and I like it. It is very nice and warm on your skin, so when it's not that warm of weather, this is very nice to wear. And to show you, I already made a white one, and I made that from a stretchy lining material, and that's a satin, of course, but make sure you have stretchy material when you use lining for that, otherwise it would not wear nicely. So a white one is always nice too, but sometimes it's too much seen through the fabric, and white is white too white, and then you better have a nude. That's why I wanted to make a nude too. So that's the slip dresses, and then I made the camisoles, a white one and a black one. And as you see, very easy. You can make just a nice and more classy camisole as the basic one that it was before. And also the white one with the lace looks very, very different and very nice from the one it was before. So you can see, when you just buy a basic tank top or a basic camisole, you can make it really nice in a very easy and quick way. And it looks way better than just a plain simple one, especially when it's peeking out a bit. I don't like when there's just a plain tank top or something underneath it. So I like how this turned out. I'm very happy with my nude slip dress that I have now too. And the white one is always handy. So I hope you liked this tutorial. I hope it was helpful to give you some more undergarments for very cheap and very easy to do. And the next clip, as I already told you, will be a jumpsuit. And I don't have the fabric here, no. But I will show you when we make it next week. It will be a dark blue, almost night blue one. So that will look very nice. So I hope you like this video. Please subscribe if you do. Please share them if you know other people that like to make, to sew themselves but are afraid to start. Show them my videos so that they can see that it's not that difficult and that you just have to start. And then you'll see it will come out very nicely. So thank you so much for watching again, and I'll see you again next week. Bye!